Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another JS drop from this dot. In this week's drop, you'll learn about the W3C technical spec ARIA from accessibility expert Nicolas Steenhout. You'll learn about when to use ARIA, its basic rules, and a whole lot more. I hope you're ready because this is going to be an awesome drop. Let's get started.
Well, hi, everyone. I'm going to be talking about ARIA. Actually, it's an ARIA 101. You've probably worked with ARIA before, but maybe you're not as familiar with what it is as possible, and this is what we're going to be talking about today. Who am I? Well, I'm Nick Steenhout. I've been doing accessibility for a very long time. I'm a consultant. I work mostly with Fortune 500 companies to help make their website accessible. I work a lot with designers and developers, and one of the things we talk about a lot is ARIA. You can find me on my blog at incl.ca. You can find my podcast, the Accessibility Rules podcast, at a11yrules.com. And if you have any question whatsoever, I'm on Twitter. I'm on Twitter a lot, and my handle there is Vavroom, V-A-V-R-O-O-M. So we're talking about ARIA. ARIA stands for Accessible Rich Internet Applications. What that is a specification by the W3C, and it was created to help make the web more accessible, specifically for assistive technologies like screen readers. Screen readers are applications that mostly blind people, but also some people with low vision and some people with dyslexia will use to interact with the web or their computers. And when ARIA came into the picture, we did not have HTML5. So there were not a lot of ways to do some of the things that we needed to do. And therefore came ARIA. Now, we use ARIA quite a bit. In fact, ARIA is everywhere on the web today. There's an organization called WebAIM, and every year they analyze 1 million web pages from the web. And this year, the 2022 report noted that home pages that had ARIA on them had 70% more errors detected than those without. So does that mean that ARIA means it's less accessible? No. What it means is too often we use ARIA without really thinking about what we're doing, or maybe not knowing what we're doing. And this is what we're going to talk about a little bit here. ARIA allows us to add roles, change properties, and change states of elements. So you can use attributes to an element, and those attributes are role. For example, you can have a div and use role button, and suddenly it's considered a button. You can change the property of something. You can say something is checked or unchecked, something is expanded or not. You can change the values. For example, you may have ARIA required equals true, or you can add a text string, or you can add an ID. We're going to talk a little bit more about strings and IDs and when it's appropriate to do that later. But the basic thing is we can manipulate elements in HTML to make them behave in different ways than their native intention. Sometimes that's good, sometimes that's bad. So let's look at a few rules of ARIA. The first rule of ARIA. And the first rule of ARIA is don't use ARIA. I say this and it sounds weird, but that's what it is. You should not use ARIA unless you have no way to do what you want to do by using native HTML. So if you're trying to get something to behave like a button, you can use the HTML element for button. If you're trying to make something behave like an image, you can use the HTML element IMG. So we have a lot of ways to do things natively in HTML. and when that option is available, that's really what you should do. And sometimes that's not always possible, but in general, you can do a lot of heavy lifting just with using HTML. Incidentally, I'm going to say this. My dog knows about 50 words and commands in English, give or take. There are about 100 HTML elements, but to do most of what we want to do, we need about half of that. So as a developer, as maybe even a designer, it might be good for you to know more HTML than my dog understands English. I say this facetiously, but the reality, as an accessibility auditor, when I do audits, about 80% of the accessibility errors I encounter, they are all tied to using HTML incorrectly. So if you pair the fact that there's a lot of HTML errors on the web and the fact that ARIA should be used only if you can't use HTML properly, and then you throw in the fact that pages that have ARIA have 70% more accessibility error on it, you start to realize that we have a problem. And I say we, I mean developers, designers, disabled people, end user, the people using our websites. So that's where we really want to be careful and intentionally do things and do things correctly. So enough lectures. Let's look at the second rule of ARIA. Don't change the semantics. And by that, I mean, if you have a button, don't say role link. So don't try to make a link into a button or a button into a link. But sometimes you really do have to. Sometimes you have no choice but to use a neutral element like a div or a span. At that point, that's when you change the semantic. Maybe you want to add semantic. Maybe you need to change it. But you have to do this very, very carefully, because when you change the semantics, screen reader users may actually not understand what element is on the page. For example, when you're using a screen reader and it comes across a button, it will say it's a button. And when you come across that, you know, oh, okay, it's a button. If I interact with this, something's going to happen. If the screen reader says, hey, this is a link, well, then you know that when you interact with the link, you're going to go somewhere. But if you change the semantic in a way that is going to be really confusing, then you've made the page more difficult to use and you've increased the cognitive load of your user, which you don't want to do. Third rule of ARIA, all interactive elements must be keyboard friendly. That's makes sense because not everybody uses a mouse, but we often find elements on the web that have been modified using ARIA, and we can interact with them with a mouse, but we can't actually interact with them with a keyboard. So an easy way to test for you, put your trackbar aside, put your trackpad aside, hide your mouse, and use your keyboard only. Use the tab key to go forward in the tab order, use shift tab to go backwards, and use either the enter key or the space bar to interact with the element. If you can do that, then you're good. If you can't do that, then you have to look at how do you make this accessible for keyboard users? Don't reinvent elements and so on and so forth. The fourth rule of ARIA, role presentation is a no-go on interactive elements. The same is true with role none or ARIA hidden. If you use these three attributes, role presentation, role none, or ARIA hidden equals true, basically you are removing all the semantics of the element, and keyboard users and screen reader users will not be able to interact with them or will not be able to understand what this thing does, which kind of defeats the purpose of having an interactive element to start with. Right. Fifth and last rule of ARIA, all interactive elements must have an accessible name. Don't have empty elements. Ensure that you have programmatic labels. If you have an input, you have to have a label, because otherwise a screen reader user will not know what that input does, what it's there for. What's this thing? Same with images. If you don't have alt text on an informative image, nobody that uses a screen reader will be able to understand what the purpose of this image is. So there you go. You have five rules of HTML. No, sorry. You have five rules of ARIA. And that should guide your approach to ARIA. But let's look at a few things that I often find problematic. Live regions. A live region is when you define a block of content on your page that may change dynamically from user interaction. Maybe you have a counter, maybe you have some messages that come through. I mean, anything that will change automatically on a page will need to be announced by a screen reader. And because screen readers typically look at a page when it's first loaded, it kind of goes in a buffer. And then that's it. So unless we programmatically tell the screen reader that something changed, the user is not going to know. So to do that, we use the attribute ARIA live. And there's three values that are typical for ARIA live. One is off. That's generally you don't put it in, because if it's off, there's no point putting it in. One is assertive, and I've seen a lot of ARIA live assertive throughout the web. And as a friend of mine used to say, my mama said, don't be rude and interrupt. And that's what ARIA assertive does. ARIA live assertive, when that's set, the screen reader is going to immediately stop what it's doing and announce the change. For example, one place I've seen this where it's particularly painful is when you're doing validation of passwords as soon as a character is typed in the field. If you use ARIA live assertive on the error message and it says, you know, password field must be 20 characters, every time somebody is typing a character, this is going to be announced. It will be very, very, very annoying. So you want to avoid using ARIA assertive. You use it only in cases where somebody's computer is about to explode. You know, you're about to log them out when they're in the middle of doing a $10,000 transaction, for example. So that might be warranted. But in 99% of cases, we don't need to use ARIA live assertive. What we want to use is ARIA live polite. Polite, the screen reader is going to finish announcing whatever it is it's announcing, and then it's going to announce the change. It's a much more relaxed and user-friendly way to use this, this attribute. You can add another attribute to a live region. You can use the ARIA atomic attribute, and this is where you decide whether you want the entire live region to be announced or only the bits that changed on that page. I only have a few minutes to go through the entire presentation, so I can't dig into that. But now you know that ARIA Atomic, this is what it does. You can look at it. There's tons of information everywhere about that. Another thing I see often is ARIA Role. No, it's not thing. You want to use Role. Just the attribute is role, not ARIA role. So we pay attention to that. Another thing that I see a lot is where we don't use the same ID more than once. That is, you don't want to use the same ID twice on the same page, because if you're using the same ID, you could confuse the screen reader. If you have an input and you're using ARIA described by to, for example, tie an error message, if you use the same ID twice, it's going to be confused as to which ID to use to describe that input, and typically only the first one is used. So avoid using non-unique IDs. Another confusion I see a lot of is ARIA label versus ARIA labeled by. One takes a text string, the other takes an ID. So ARIA labeled by, this is something you use when, for example, you don't actually have a label element. You don't actually have a label on your input, but you have text there that's already allowing for using that will label an input. So you would use the ID. So you use a separate element's ID, and that will give you programmatically tied information about the input. The other one, ARIA label, then you use a text string. So you would put something in the input itself and text, and then that becomes programmatically available for screen readers. The problem with both ARIA label and ARIA labeled by is that while this becomes available for screen reader users, it may not be available for speech input users, or it may not be available for some users with cognitive impairments. So we're going back to the first rule of ARIA here, where using the label element would be better. There's a lot of stuff within ARIA. And one of the problem is a lot of that stuff, the elements, the roles, the values, the properties, the states, they don't always work with all assistive technologies and all browsers. So one thing you can do, you can go check on a11ysupport.io and check whether or not that is an element you can use. Now, that site is a great first step. It's going to help you identify what's going on, but some of the tests are a little bit old. So if you see that something is 2 or 3 years old, you may want to run your own tests. And if you do, and you find something different from what's on the ALI support page, then you may want to give back to the page and say, hey, we can update this. The last thing I'd like to leave with you is this idea of intentionality. I said the first rule of ARIA is don't use ARIA unless you really need to. So you have to be intentional about how you use ARIA. And you be deliberate, and then once you've used that properly, you have to ensure that what you did matches with your intention. And you do have to do some test. You do manual testing, you do automated testing, and then you do critically functional testing to make sure that you haven't included unintended consequences. You haven't done something that actually breaks things rather than fixes things from an accessibility perspective. So that's that. If you have questions, you can reach me on Twitter is probably the best way, but you can also send me an email, nic@incl.ca. So thank you, and see you around the web.